Right, we'll just give it a minute or two for people to join. All right, everyone, welcome to yet another interesting session on DogSpot. So today we have Navneet Raj from Bangalore, who is the founder of the Bangalore Horse Riding School, a charming little school here in Bangalore, where he trains both adults and children on right from basic to advanced level and sport riding. And he also has a lot of other parallel, very interesting activities like corporate leadership programs actually through horses. So today we have Navneet here to enlighten us about some of the indigenous breeds of horses in India. So this really promises to be a very interesting session. Right, so welcome Navneet, and thank you for joining us here. So over to you, Navneet. Could you tell us a little bit about what you do in Bangalore?
Thank you, Subhadra. Good evening to all, one and all. Thanks for DogSpot for giving me an opportunity to connect with more people and talk about my view on the indigenous breeds and overall what is today's indigenous breeds, how they are being brought to sport, and from war horse to a marriage horse, then now back to sport. So can we have that slide so that we give more light on that?
Well, so as you can see here, you know, pretty much what I think all of us have understood in the past about indigenous horses were these beautiful horses here that, you know, on the right side, we could see them, you know, actually fighting in wars, whereas on the left, this is, you know, what a lot of us today would have seen in different shadis around the country. So Navneet, tell us, you know, when you speak about indigenous horses, what really are we talking about? What kind of horses are we talking about in India?
Yeah, we are talking about the Marwari horses and the Kathiawari horses mainly. And as well as we have some more horses like from Sindhi to even Deccan horses and all those. But mainly today we are focusing on Marwari, Kathiawari and Sindhi horses. These horses were more in the battlegrounds initially. They were bred for mainly for the battlegrounds. So to encounter any kind of threat while in the desert areas or in the mountain regions or any kind of conditions, these horses were really very good. And they were like hand to hand, and they were just fighting just next to the warriors, just like another warrior. So you could see in the right side, you could see a horse rearing almost to the elephant level there. This is a horse called Chetak from Rana Pratap's thing. And this is a Rana Pratap horse called Chetak. And this horse could rear up to the elephant level. And then the king, Rana Pratap used to the dagger or whatever the sword, what he had in his hand. So this is the kind of fighting abilities these horses had. And after the king's era, then the English invasions and all those things, then our horses landed up to the marriage and these kind of things. And more, it was branded saying that these horses are not good for sport. These horses are not good for anything, just only for marriages and these kind of things. So now we are reviving more in the down south with the more of sport with these horses. We are bringing them on the mainstream in the sport. As you see, this is called tent pecking, and the right side one is a tent pecking, and the left one is more of safari. So these horses are doing really great in today in all over the world, I could say. When you compare with any horse, when it comes to tent pecking, India is one of the best team India has in tent pecking. Till today, India holds the record. India and Pakistan is one of the two best countries and the best teams which are all over the world. People come to train from all over the world in India as well as in Pakistan to get trained for the tent pecking on the Marwari horses or the Kathiawari or the Sindhi horses on our indigenous breeds, which are doing so well. As well as in safaris, you could see like these horses travel a long distance, roughly within a week's time, they travel around 200 to 300 kilometers from one point to another point in the safari. So that which you could see every year at the Pushkar Mela, like the horses come to Mela from 200 to 300 kilometers away on a safari. A lot of foreigners who come to ride these horses and see the safari, or see the Pushkar Mela also at the time of the Diwali. But this time, because of the COVID, we didn't have Pushkar Mela. And these breeds have been really very good, because I personally, we work with these breeds. We have these breeds in our riding school. They are really good in riding. As well as we do a lot of safaris in and around Nandi Hills, where we see a lot of positive feel from the riders who come and ride these horses. So I would really recommend everybody and who are been riding or want to ride can try these horses. They'll really feel good about it.
Yeah. So that's really interesting to know, Navneet. And, you know, I guess, you know, like so many of our other indigenous breeds, you know, whether it be dogs, whether it be, you know, cattle, whether it be, you know, now horses, it's just been underplayed a great deal. So tell me, I mean, what do you think were the reasons for, you know, such gallant horses, like, you know, horses that were used as war horses, to actually, you know, just be used today in nothing but, you know, marriages, you know, grossly underestimating their potential, really?
Yeah. See, like in the English era, mainly in the English era. So, like always, like as the Indians are being underestimated, as well as the horses from cattle, everything was underestimated, and they knew that these horses had the potential to fight. So they saw what is the strength of an Indian soldier or a king. So the main strength was the horse, where he could travel in a very short distance. He could travel a long distance in a very short time. So that ability these horses had, they used to, they are very loyal to their masters. They are very sturdy. They are very hardworking. These kind of horses, they are very, like our indigenous breeds, like, you know, they know the terrain. So they are so well in the desert. They're so well on the mountains and anything to do with. So they knew where to cut this and how to go about it. So they had to, first thing is that they had to reduce the size of an army. As in they conquered any king, the first thing they did was to reduce the size of the army so that they can't fight back. So they made it a point that they can't have more horse or very limited horses to only to certain kings or whatever it is. So no common man could have any horse, because they suspected that they can carry message to one place to another on these horses. Because those days the horse was the only means of transport to carry message or anything to one place to another in a very quick way. So they saw that this as a threat. So they had to cut down this. And so that's how they brought all these breeds to an end. And the only limited breeds were kept in the palaces and here there. So later they didn't know what to do with these breeds, because after the independence or after the English era, the kings didn't have much to work with, because they didn't have any war to fight. So they didn't have anything to do. So they didn't know what to do with horses. So these horses were given to the caretakers. The people who were taking care of these horses were given these horses to them. So they didn't know what to do with horses. So all they knew was to keep them, but still they have to survive. They have to take care of them. So all they could do is take these horses to marriages and the common functions where they used to earn some money out of it, and they could take care of these horses. Slowly, then they started branding these horses, saying that the Marwari horses or the Kathiawar horses or the indigenous breeds are good only for the marriages, not for anything else. Because the English didn't ride these horses because they were too fast. They couldn't control these horses. So they couldn't ride. They couldn't, the fact is they couldn't ride these horses. They were more comfortable on a thoroughbred or an English horse. You know, like a very English style of riding. So that was one reason. And later, slowly, they had to promote their own breeds, wherein they brought only these breeds, like the thoroughbreds, into India, and more thoroughbreds into India. And these horses slowly started getting into a threat. So that's how it all happened. So, but now we are working a lot in the down south also to revive these breeds to mainstream, getting into sport, basically. We are using in the riding schools, we are using for jumping, we are using for tent pecking, we are using for safaris and a lot more things. So,
oh, it's interesting. So, I'm glad that we've gotten, I'm glad that we've gotten to a point where we now recognize, you know, all the good qualities of these horses. So tell me, Navneet, what are most, you know, common indigenous breeds of horses that we have in India today?
So we have commonly, we have Marwaris, we have Kathiawar, we have Sindhi, we have Manipuri ponies, and we have Bhutia. And 1 minute, let me see. This is the recognized horse breeds in India, which has been recognized by ICAR. That's again working for the animal thing. And these breeds are recognized by the government of India. And they have some literature on these horses, which is available on the website. I've given the link of the website also. Anybody who is interested can get through this and know more about these breeds and where they come from and what it is. But I'll just give you a small introduction about the Marwari horse, the Kathiawari, Sindhi, and as well as the ponies also, and the other breeds also. So shall we start with the Marwari horses?
That'll be good.
Or we can start even. This is Bhutia. This is a this is one of the pony breeds. This is called as Bhutia. This is more you can see in Sikkim, Arunachal Pradesh, and these areas. These are very good ponies, and they are very good in the hilly regions, the mountain regions. They carry a lot of weight. They now they have been used more to carry whatever the essential service needs. People around the mountain areas, but if not also for riding, they are really good. We have one or two horses in our riding school also. I'm talking about the pony, one or two. They are really good at riding also. So this is one of the pony. This is an indigenous pony what we have, and they are more similar to the Manipuri ponies also. So the can we have another slide? This is a Kathiawar breed. More of a you could see, if you are talking about a Kathiawar breed, this is from the region of Kathiawar, and which is towards the Gujarat area, and this is morely the places where Rajkot, Bahawalpur, and these areas are more of this Kathiawar breeds. These Kathiawar breeds were those days mainly used in war, the Marwar as well as the Kathiawar breeds. These are extremely strong horses, very loyal. And now in today's era, now they have been using these in the armies, as well as they are using this in the police forces more for the patrolling of areas in the Gujarat area. And these were used, these Kathiawar breeds were more used in the Maratha army at the time of the Marathas, more towards when they were invading from the Pune region towards the Rajasthan and Gujarat and these areas. So the Maratha army used a lot of Kathiawar breeds, where we have the records of for that. And if we talk about, these are the Kathiawar breeds. So shall we go in detail later, or you want to introduce these breeds initially and then?
If you could give us an overview of all the breeds, and then, we'd just like to understand a little bit more after that about, you know, how do you actually tell the difference between some of these common ones, like, the Marwari and the Kathiawari and the Sindhi ones?
Sure. So then we have the, can we go for the next slide? So then this is a Manipuri pony. This is Manipuri ponies are almost similar to the Bhutias and the other ponies and Zanskar ponies also. These Manipuri ponies are, you have a one special character is like the Manipuri, like we had polo first started with these Manipuri ponies. Manipur is the founding place for polo. And people still today, we have the Manipur Pony Club where the people come in from all over the world to try Manipuri ponies and the polo playing. So these ponies are very good in polo playing. So that's one great thing that we have, that the polo was introduced in India on these Manipuri ponies. Can you have another one? Yeah, this is a Marwari horse. Like, again, I said, these comes from the Rajasthan area. More of this Udaipur, Jodhpur, and Jaisalmer, and these areas. This is close. These areas are more close towards the Gujarat and Rajasthan in between these borders. So this is called a Marwari horse. So they have a beautiful look, and one of the really a great horse. And I really love these horses a lot. The Marwaris and the Kathiawar, all the indigenous breeds. Yeah. So we'll go in detail later. So can we have another? So this is also one of our ponies, what we find in the Himachal Pradesh and these areas, the mountain areas. If somebody would have gone towards the these north area, like these are more used for, you know, like more of tourist places you could find these horses. And these are also our one of our indigenous breeds, very sturdy, and they are doing really great in the mountain areas. Yeah, this is also one of our indigenous breeds. This is the Zanskar horses. These are more found in the Jammu and Kashmir and these areas. If somebody would have traveled there, they would have surely seen these horses for the Amarnath and these areas and all. This is also really a great ponies what we have. And yeah, this is the Sindhi horse. This is more found in the Kutch region. Now the Sindh region is more towards the Pakistan. So, but these horses you can find more in Pakistan area, areas like they breed for them for tent packing and other things. But still, we have some more breeds left in India also, which is to the border of Pakistan and India, the Kutch region and these things. These horses are really good at the desert areas. So they are one of the sturdiest horses what we could see. In the indigenous breeds, one of the sturdiest horses that we see in the indigenous breeds. Okay, this is, we don't have much records on these horses, but these are called the Deccan horses. They, these horses were more used with the Maratha army and the Maratha regiment. They say that these horses were more cross between the Marwars, Kathiawar, and the local ponies. From the down south, so these breeds were developed and which were really good in the mountain areas. So these were used more in the Maratha army for war and the.
Nahid, I have a question on these Dakini horses. So you said we don't really have too many records about these. So what does that mean? You know, do they not exist anymore? Do we not see this breed around anymore?
We don't see it's not existing since the first the whole of thing is like we have very limited records on all our indigenous breeds because we don't have any DNA testing done. Like, you know, you could say that exactly this is what it is.
Okay,
it's all with the features and looks and the records dating back in the history. So we look comparing with that the historians or people who have done the research on these horses have given us some data which is available on the net and other places also. So we have only the data on that. But when you say that purely this is a Marwar, this is the purest of Kathiawar, or I don't see anything as such like that, because there is a lot of internal breedings have been done. That mm-hmm. might be because of, you know, like anything to do with like the now this is like all the states have been divided and seen. But now earlier geographically like the Rajasthan was in a different and in the Gujarat and these areas were mixed. So more of now still the Rajasthan and Gujarat area is very close to each other. So the Khatewar and the Marwar breeds are always, they have been mixed with the Khatewar stall into a Marwar mares and or a Marwar stall into a Khatewar mares. So I don't see the purest of it. And if at all there is very, very few horses left. So which there is a lot of research going on them to understand these breeds and see from where these breeds have been coming in. But when we talk about the down south or even towards the Bombay and these areas of Pune, Maharashtra and all, we have this Deccan horses. They are a mix of a pony and the other horses. That's what they say. But we don't have much of records on that. But we see a lot of sculptures in the temple and those things. We see a lot of sculptures. We see a lot of paintings of these horses. But we don't see those horses in the down south. So we need there is a lot of research needed to understand what happened to these breeds.
Got it. Yeah.
So shall we start with any of the breeds that want to know more? I think Marwar, Khatewar, and the Sindhi breeds.
Yeah, that'll be nice, Navneet, because I think we see a lot of these very commonly, especially the Marwari and the Khatewaris, but kind of hard for some of us novices to actually tell the difference between these three breeds, including the Sindhi.
So, shall we start with one of those so that I can give a small?
Anisha, could we just beam up the PPT? Yeah, could we just switch to the Marwari and the Kathiawari slides? Thank you.
When we talk about the Marwari horses, as I told you, these horses are more from the Udaipur, Jodhpur, and these areas. And these horses are really good in riding and endurance and long distance riding, and they're now more used in safaris and sport, other sports also they've been using. The one speciality about these horses is the ears. You could see the ears are very nicely curved like this, like more like a scorpion. You have seen more of people who've seen the scorpion, like that. The curvature is like that. But in the Khatewar breeds, the curvature is there, but it is not. It is not like that. I can show in another breed. So it is more like, it doesn't give an arch shape. It gives a little a different shape, like a pyramid, like more of a cone like this. But in the Marwar, can you please switch it on to Marwar? So when we see Marwar horses, there is a more of a kind of an arch mark, arch shape, mm-hmm. with the ears. So this is one speciality mm-hmm. about them. And these ears, when we're talking about the Marwar breed specifically, they are close to, I'm talking about approximately the length of the Marwar ears would be around 18 centimeter. Okay. The length of the ears would be 18 centimeter. And they have a very beautiful eye. It is more called as a pigeon eye. If you could compare this and a pigeon eye, it is more similar to a pigeon eye. So it is not very much bulging eye, but they have a very flat, it's more called as a pigeon eye. And as well as their neck and their head part, it is more like a straight thing. They don't have any convex or concave kind of a profile on their head. They have a very straight line. And the neck, when it comes to neck, the lower neck is nice, very thick, and the upper neck is little, compared to the lower neck, it is little small. And they have a very curved neck. It is called more as the peacock neck. You could mm-hmm. see when you see a peacock, like how it is just putting its head down and like that, you could see a peacock neck more in the Marwari horses. These are the one similarities what you see. And with the eyes, with the nostril, and as well as their forehead, the forehead is always straight and coming down. So that is one what you could see. And when it comes to the height of a Marwari horse, it is roughly from 60 to 60. I'm talking about a stallion, a well-grown stallion, is roughly from somewhere from 59 to 60, 61, 60, 60, 63, you can expect a Marwari horse. So when it in indigenous breeds, Marwari horses are one of the biggest horses. Like when you see Kathiawar or the Sindhi, wouldn't be of this height. And you're talking about the back. The Marwari horses, the body type is like the back, we call this as a croup, like the back is nice rounded. The Marwari horses have a nice rounded back with a deep seat. So these horses are really looking, they look very majestic in it. And approximately, the size is like the face profile. If you see the length of the head, if you're talking about, it would be roughly around 60 centimeters. For a Marwari, for a Kathiawari, it will be a little smaller, and the jaw at the bottom would be a little more bulged compared to the Marwari horses. So, yeah, can we go back to Kathiawari horses? I can just show you the difference between a Kathiawari. This is a more of a straight photo. You could see the ears. When you see the ears of a Marwari and a Kathiawari, you could see more of a one touching like this. But for a Marwari horse, it will be more like this. And for a Kathiawari, it will be overlapping, but like this. Okay, for a Marwari, it is like this. Okay, this is the best thing what you could judge with the horses as in you see. But and the Kathiawari face, the horse face is, compared to the Marwari, it is little smaller. The nostrils are big, and they have a more of a concave profile on the face. Like, you know, like the forehead, then it comes, there's a deep depth, slight depth in it, and then close like this. So they have a like kind of a concave like this. The profile is something, if I can show this. Yeah, a little bit of slopey like this for the Kathiawari. And their ears are roughly like they have a small short ears, like around 15 centimeters the ears are. For the Marwari it is 18. For the roughly I'm talking about, for a Kathiawari it is 15 centimeters. The eyes of a Marwari, sorry, of a Kathiawari breed would be more you know, like popping out, you know, like more like a frog, like, you know, if you say compare with a frog like features on the eye because of the short face. You could see the eyes popping up a little. Mm-hmm. But in a Marwari you could see more of a flat eye with a more of like the pigeon kind of a finish, you know. It's really mm-hmm. And the neck, if you see, compared to the Marwari and the Kathiawari have a shorter neck. Not, they also have a slight curve in the neck, but not as curve as the Marwars have. These breeds have a shorter neck. Basically, the down neck is also thick, as well as the upper neck is slightly smaller than the back part. So the neck is, compared to the Marwari horses, the necks are a little small. And then comes to the back, they also have the rounded back, the deep seat and all those things. So they are the height of a Kathiawari breed is more, if you see, it is not like a Marwari, it is more to do with 58, 60, max is a 60. And a well-built, you could see more of a nice stout horse in the Kathiawari breeds. And the nostrils are really little big. Mm-hmm. And the face profile, if you see, the face would be roughly around 53 centimeters, you know, like the length, I'm talking about the length of the face would be around 53 centimeters. In a Marwari, you could see, expect a 60 centimeter. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So then comes with the markings and these. And these colors, what we are showing in this profile, this color is more available on a Kathiawari breeds. You could see these colors.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and Marwaris, you could say you can find with a lot of other colors also. And Kathiawaris also, you come with multiple colors. You could see black, you could see a lot of other shades also. That is one best thing in the indigenous breeds, is they come with multiple colors. So people can choose what color they want, mm-hmm. not like the restricted colors in thoroughbreds or something. So when we talk about Sindhi now, so can we switch to Sindhi? No, this is Manipuri. Can we switch to? The next one, please.
The next one.
Yeah. This is called the Sindhi breed. So this Sindhi breeds are more, you could find in the desert areas and more in the Kutch areas of thing, and the Sindh region of Pakistan, as I told you. These breeds are even in Jaisalmer and these areas also you can find in Rajasthan and these things. These breeds have one specialty, is the Rawal Chal. They call it as a Rawal Chal in the local language. This is more to do with, you know, like the horse is comfortable on the fifth gait. More, it's not like with walk, trot or canter or gallop. It's more to do with the Rawal Chal. So these Rawal Chals are used in the local racing in the village areas, or more of Rajasthan and Gujarat and these areas. They use, they have a local race where they use this Rawal Chal a lot. So these horses are good to do with that. And these, you can see the ear set. The ear doesn't touch each other. There is a curve. There is a curve there, but they don't touch. So they are a little away from each other. So this is one easy way to identify a Sindhi horse from a Marwari or a Kathiawar breed. Okay. And this face, if you say these have a convex profile. They don't have a concave. They have a convex profile. A slightly, you could see from the top, it is a slight bulge in the front. For a Marwar, it is slope like this, just straight. For a Kathiawar, it is slightly a concave, and for Sindhi, it is like a more of a convex. Okay, this is a more of a convex like this a profile. You could see in the face, and the ears are not touching. The ear length is also, for example, from 19 centimeter to 22 centimeter. The ear length is. The length of the ear in the indigenous breeds in the is like the Sindhis are very long. They have a very long ears when you compare with the Marwar or the Kathiawar breeds. And their eyes are less, they have a slight bulge in their eyes, but they're very less bulging compared to a Kathiawar breed. And the neck, when you come to the neck part, they don't have a curvature, or they don't have a kind of a peacock neck. They have a more of a straight neck. And from top and bottom, they are more thick, and they have a very straight neck. And the back is also, you could see the back, they have a straight back, and you could see at the last, close to the tail there is a slope. They call it as a slopey back also, or even a slopey crew, they call this part. So there's a straight, more the body is more of a, like on the back length, if you see, it is more of a straight line. So this in this breeds, this is one. And when you talk about the height of these breeds, it is 55 to 61. And when you see, talk about the face profile, length of a face profile is roughly around 50 to 55, you could guess the length of the face profile. Again, let me repeat it. For Marwars, you have the face profile as 60 centimeters. In the Kathiawar, you have the face profile is 53. And for a Sindhi, it is 50 to 55. And these are one of the best horses I would suggest for any of the desert condition horses for a ride, for safaris or anything to do with.
Wow.
Tell me something, Ravneet. How, at least sentiment-wise, how different are these horses if we were to compare them to, either the thoroughbreds or warm bloods or Arabians or, any of the other non-Indian, more common breeds?
Like when you compare with, every horse, every breed has basically, it all matters. The temperament matters in the horses, like how we bring them up. It all matters with the person who has the horse, like how good we are with them in bringing up them, and how gently we handle them. That is very important with horses. Yes, they are very fast horses. They are very quick in their move. The gaits are very small and very quick. They have a very quick gait. So, and very sturdy horses and very strong. And they don't give up that easily. You talk about any of these three breeds, they don't give up. And when it comes to running, it comes to refusing, or when it comes to anything, they don't give up. They are on it. They fight to their last breath. That is what these breeds are mainly focusing. But I wouldn't say about the thoroughbred, but thoroughbred horses are more docile and soft-natured horses. They are more towards, more like for sprinters they are. They can't travel. They are not that great on the long distance traveling. They are more for the race track and more of a short distance, like a sprinters they are. So whatever you have the size race course, that kind of a size thing, they are very good in this as far as sprinters. But yes, you can also, like the temperament wise, I would say that we have been having these horses, but we don't find anything different from thing, but they are a little more, you can call them as very alert horses, or they sense threats or anything to do with just like that. So one best thing I want to tell you about is, like in the war field, these horses were used, and when they're the cavalry used to be the army, when they used to march towards the enemy line, So these horses could sense, you know, like where the threat is coming from. So the soldier sitting on the horse could easily locate, okay, whether the threat is from the right or left, where the threat is from. You know, the ears could turn and just, you know, move the ears like this. So it turns 180 degree. Basically, the ears turn 180 degree, and they could sense the threat. So that was one way of the soldier to be alert also. So this is, I could say that these horses are really very loyal ones. And I don't see anything as a negative or a minus point in these breeds in terms of behavior or in terms of their this one. So they are really good horses to be around.
Okay, so I mean, tell me one thing, you know, again, we are very interested to understand more about the temperament. You know, are these horses suited to novice riders, or you know, I mean, is there any difference really? I mean, can any, just about anyone ride them, or you know, should it be somebody who's, you know, had a lot of experience riding with, you know, different kinds of you know, horses, that you know, would do better with any of the indigenous breeds?
No, I don't see anything as such like that. But only thing is that as a rider, they have to be open to all kind of horses. It is not that, you know, like they get trained with a thoroughbred or they get trained with a pony or any other breed and they say that I'm comfortable with only these horses. Because when you go or travel around, you would find different breeds of horses. And I think as a rider, everybody should ride any horse is available and get used to that. That is very important. In the Marwari horses, what you could see is that they just, as I told you, the neck, they keep more like a peacock neck, and they move forward, forward moving horses. And their gaits are very different. When compared to a thoroughbred, the gaits are different. So the up down, when they do an up down, they have, the rider has to be really quick in doing an up down. In a thoroughbred, yes, they are more because of the strides what they put in, a long stride. So the rider has enough time to get up and do, basically have enough time to do their up down. But in a Marwar horse, they have to be quick. Pony, they have to be much more quicker because ponies have a much more shorter strides. So when they ride a pony, it will be more bumpy. So if they don't do an up down, so that's it. That's, I don't see any. Anybody can ride a Marwari horse or a Kathari horse or anything to do with. And again, it all matters like how they have been trained. When even a thoroughbred or any other horse also could be could not be giving a good ride until it's trained well or it's been schooled well. Basically, the horses have to be schooled well. So I don't see any difference. Anybody can ride a Marwari horse or any indigenous breed.
So Navneet, tell me, what goes into grooming and maintaining these horses? Are they, you know, very high maintenance?
No, these indigenous breeds are, when it comes to maintenance, they are very low maintenance. And it's not that you need to give a very sophisticated place for them, but you need to provide a reasonable, good, stable shelter, and those things are essential. But apart from that, when it comes to breeding, when it comes to giving them the poor bedding part or anything, these horses are not that, compared to the thoroughbreds, or if you compare with a warmbred, I don't see as high maintenance horses. They are very less maintained horses, and the consumption of the food consumption also with these horses are very less compared to the warmbred or. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't see any maintenance part also, and their hoof is also strong. They have a very strong hoof. So when you see with the compared to a Marwar or a Kathiawar breed, comparing with a thoroughbred, the thoroughbred hoofs are very fragile. So, but the Marwari breeds horses, the hoofs are very strong. Even the Kathiawar and the Sindhi breeds, you know, like the hoofs are very strong. So we don't see any maintenance as a big challenge or a big issue, or we don't see anything as such. It is really good to maintenance part is nothing that great with, compared to
how about training, how difficult or you know, how easy is it to, you know, break these horses in and to train them?
See, the first question, when you say just training these horses, it all depends who is doing these things, like, you know, like how well they are trained to school these horses. And all you have to do is, like, you know, like the first, as a trainer, they have to be more calm and docile to train these horses. So if they can understand the animal and train, whether when it comes to any horse, I'm talking about whether it's the indigenous or even from a pony to a warm blood or anything, they have to first understand the animal. So first they understand the animal, they need to give that space to them, and then only they can start training them. But I don't see any big challenge in training these horses compared to a thoroughbred.
Okay. So just a little bit back to the origin of these horses, Navneet. So, I mean, we know, you know, India has never had wild horses. Horses technically are not endemic to India. So, I mean, where did they come from? How did they come about? And, you know, where is it that, you know, today we have these different breeds of indigenous horses here?
Yeah, see, this is a very debatable subject. There's a lot of myths saying that we didn't have horses, or only the horses came from Persia and Europe and this, that, and all kind of things, the stories. But I don't. It's my own personal view that no, India had horses very, very long back. You know, like you could read our any of the Mahabharatas in Vedas, and everywhere there is a reference to horse. So India had horses, but we are not sure about what kind of horses were there, or those things. But as what we have now is these Marwar and Kathiawar and the Sindhi or the ponies and these kind of things, which we have to say, basically, like, you know, much before these breeds, we don't know what kind of things we had. Surely we had, I think we would have had, because if not, how the kings would have fought their war, or how they would have conquered, captured the other things. And I don't personally believe that we didn't have horse, or which has come from civilization is much, much more older than the European or the English civilizations.
Wow, that's interesting to know. So the sad fact, I think, is we just don't have much documentation, and I think still a lot of research going on with this. So tell me again, Navneet, sorry, can you hear me? Yeah, we can hear you, Navneet. Yeah. So, tell me, what kind of...
There's a lot of research. You know,
can you hear me, Navneet?
Subhra, I'm not able to hear you.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yeah, now I can hear you, please.
Yeah, so I was saying, you know, what kind of, you know, sports and different kind of recreation do you feel they are most suited to these days?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you, Subhadra. Sorry.
All right. Give me a second. Yeah, can you hear me now, Navneet?
Hello.
Can you hear me now, Navneet?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me, Navneet?
Yes, now I can.
Yeah. So what kind of, sport are they, most... what kind of sports, you know, do people seem to indulge in with these horses these days in the current scenario?
These horses, all these three breeds are really, really good with any of the sport, what do you call as like endurance. Today, now endurance sport is picking up a lot. In India, I'm talking about mainly. And people who have been traveling from abroad to India to see this sport, like endurance, or participate in this endurance sport, who have been riding this Marwari, Kathiawar or Sindhi breeds are really feeling that these are great horses. They are doing really good in the endurance races. I'm talking about endurance is more like a marathon. If people will know about the horse related to endurance. This is more to do with 20 kilometer race, 40, 60. I'm talking about kilometers in a day traveling. Every 20 kilometer, there's a loop with the, and the heart rate is checked with horses. And once they are fit to go for the next 20, then they are passed out. There's a panel of vet who are there, a huge team of vet. So the horses travel in a day. I'm talking about in a few hours, like 20 kilometer, 40, 60, 80, 100 and 120. These, I'm talking about these breeds are capable of going to even 100 kilometers a day. Given a bit of intervals, I'm talking about every 20 kilometers, the horse has to come for the vet check. There's a vet check done. Once the vet proves that the horse is fit to go for another 20 kilometer, then only the horse is sent. It's not that at one stretch the horse goes for 100 kilometer or something like that. It's every 20 kilometers, there's a loop, or at every 20 kilometers, there's a vet who checks the horse and if for any lameness or the heart rate and everything. If the horse is fit to go, then only there. But again, these horses are well trained for that, and they have in them this endurance, is that they could take it and they can travel a long distance. But same time, the horses have to be trained for that. Not at once you can't go for a 20 kilometer or 40 kilometer, because the endurance has a rule that any start with a 20 kilometer and then get into a 40, and even they can start with a 10 kilometer ride and then 20, then 40, 60, 80 and 120. So which in India these are picking up a lot, and all over the world I could been seeing that the a lot of people talking about the indigenous breeds that in endurance they are doing well. But only problem is we have an export ban on these horses, so we can't export these horses. I'm talking about Marwar and horses. So we are not able to show them in the foreign soil. I'm talking about in the indigenous. Like when it comes to indigenous, more in the Western country or in Dubai, they are only the Arabian horses and a mix of Arabian into a thoroughbred or more of horses or mixed with the European horses. So these horses are doing good at endurance. But I would say that if their indigenous breeds are allowed to export and these horses can compete with those horses in the foreign soil, I don't see any kind of I don't see any horse getting near to that other than an Arabian horse. I really because I have ridden first. I have been into endurance and I've been riding endurance, so I know what they are. So I have trained some horses and I've been riding them. So regularly I take part in endurance race. So they are magnificent animals, I would say. So easy, just like that, they take 20, 40 kilometers. So if you just train them, they just keep going. So that is one. So yeah, that is one good sport to pick up. People, it's one line I wanted to add with. Like anybody who knows to ride a horse, who could control their horse with a walk, trot, canter, also can get into endurance sport and participate in endurance sport. You need not to be very good, you know, like years of skills to become an endurance rider. So all you need to know is you need to understand the animal and you need to not push the animal at once when you go. It is not a race kind of a thing, who comes first, but who brings the horse fit and with the heart rate and the without any lameness to the finish point is the winner, basically. You can take a horse on a trot, canter, on a walk, whatever it is, but thing is you have to bring your horse back safe to the finish line with good heart rate, and as in the horse comes to the finish line, it needs within few minutes the heart rate has to come down. So that is the whole point. But there are a lot of points which the FEI has designed for the indigenous, where we can share those details. Whoever is interested to know more about endurance and getting into endurance sport, we can help them, not a problem. Apart from that we have tent pecking. One of the slides we used to see, this tent pecking sport is one of the war techniques which Indian soldiers had used. What is tent pecking is more like, you know, like there's a set of, I think there's another slide called for the tent pecking. The sport we can do. This, the right one, the right side one, that is called a tent pegging. A rider sitting on a horse with a full speed, he comes, there's a target there, it's called the peg. So the rider picks up the peg. So those days, the soldiers used to be on the horseback. The enemies used to, in the nighttime, they used to camp their tents. So they used to peg the tents out, and then there was another horsemen used to just run over the tents. That's how they used this as an art of war. So this is one of the Indian sport, or Indian soldiers had fought this in the battle. And this was more helped in the World War One. Our horses, mainly I just slipped out of it. So our indigenous horses have participated in World War One and Two also. All the way the horses have been taken in World War One to now what you call as Israel is being, those days the Ottomans had were there. So the Indian soldiers had gone from here all the way from India to liberate Israel. When you're talking about the Mysore Lancers or the Jodhpur Lancers or the Hyderabad Lancers were three part of the Lancers who had gone all the way from India to the Persian Gulf, all over, wherever the Indian soldiers have fought their battle in the World War One and Two also. And then next comes the left side, what you see is a safari. The horses travel a lot in the safari, given point of time per day, they travel 30, 40 kilometers in a safari, and then they have a camping and all those things. Yeah.
Wow, that's really interesting. I mean, there's just so much potential in them that's, you know, just so been underplayed. So tell me, Navneet, I understand you are the South India convener of the Indigenous Horse Society of India. Could you tell us a little bit about the society, what the society does, you know, what they are trying to promote about these horses, and how are they trying to do all of this?
Yeah, the Indigenous Horse Society is mainly working more to revive these breeds, basically, and bring them to the mainstream. When we called as mainstream, that because all these years, we didn't have any records of these horses. That is one way we lost these horses long back. As you see in the thoroughbreds, they have a pedigree chart. If you pick up a thoroughbred, if you have a passport, you can track the horse back for 300, even 100, 200, 300 years back, you can track the horse, who's the father and who's the mother and from where the lineage comes from and all those things, the records. On the net, it is available where you can track, check them with their name and with the from which stud farm they've been bred and from where there it is and where the father is from, whether it's from US, UK or from Ireland or what it is. You can get a full list of pedigree, almost I would say you can date back to 200 years also, 100 to 200 years back also. But with this Marwari horses, we didn't have, but now the Indigenous Horse Society has, with all the effort they have come out now, they have tied up with the Stud Book Authority of India, who maintains the records for the thoroughbred also, and they have been nice and kind to us to accept this proposal of keeping of these records. And talking about the DNA part of the indigenous breeds, whether it might be we have Marwari, Kathiawari, Sindhi, or any breeds for that matter, from a pony. If somebody has a pony also, they can register their pony, they can get a microchip done, they can get a passport done, they can get a DNA done for the pony. These things are available at the Indigenous Horse Society, and they get their passport for their horse. So where, because if somebody loses their horse or they want to sell it, they want to take it abroad, maybe we have today ban, but tomorrow once the ban is lifted, then they can do that. Like and or not only that, we can create a record for them. Basically, they have a passport, they have a microchip, they have all the details filled in that, a vet signs, and he gives the marking of those horses. And if somebody has a horse, they don't know what breed it belongs to, the Indigenous Horse Society helps them to identify the breed and register in that particular breed standard. So that is one best thing that the Indigenous Horse Society is doing for it. And anybody who have horses who want to register their horse they can do it through the Indigenous Horse Society.
All right, lovely. So I think we are, you know, just a couple of minutes short of the hour. So considering all that you have told us about indigenous horses in India, Navneet, is there any message that you have regarding these to, you know, all the horse enthusiasts in India?
All my message to the riders or the horse lovers is that it is our responsibility to, you know, like to look into our indigenous breeds than getting into any kind of an, the English breeds. Please do ride our indigenous breeds. You will really like it and love it. And these are one of the wonderful animals that we have to save them, basically, by riding, bringing them to the mainstream, bringing them to the sport. Basically, I would recommend each and every rider to get into any one of the sport with the indigenous breeds, where that is one way we can save these breeds. If not, I don't see much of these breeds are used in any of the other form. Or you could see one or somewhere the other, these horses have been pulling some tonga or some in the marriage hall somewhere, you know, their life ends there. But when as a rider, that we bring them back to any of the sport, might be just even a pleasure riding. You can have a horse for even for a pleasure ride, you know, like who want to pick them up, or they get into any kind of a sport. So then this is one way where we can promote them and we can save them. That's what I mean to. So that which already we are doing it. So we are trying our best to keep. We have around close to around 8 to 9 indigenous breeds, including some ponies also. Some miniature ponies also. Mm-hmm.
What we have. Right.
So that's one way. If these breeds have to multiply or somebody wants to breed them, so there should be a reason behind it. Then when they're breeding it, then if there's a sport growing, then it is really, it makes sense to breed these horses. So that's what I say. So my message is very clear that we have to save these breeds. So that's really one thing that we are working for it.
I think it's a fantastic job, you know, all of you are doing with these breeds. So I have one last question, and you know, I'm really interested to know. So I understand you do some kind of corporate leadership programs at your center in Bangalore. So could you let us know what exactly goes into these programs?
This leadership program is mainly to get connect with the horses and the human being. You know, like it is more to do is like you feel when you get go close to a horse, when you handle a horse, you know, like you know what is your strength, what is the strength of the horse, when you need to give and when you need to take it back. You can't, mm-hmm. It is not always you think that you have a rope in your hand and a whip in your hand, things work. No, things don't work like that. So this is more to make people realize and understand and connect with horses. So this is working out really well. A lot of people who have undergone these kind of programs are having a lot of positive change in them. And the way now they look at the other person is entirely changed. So you need to be nice. First, we need to be nice to the horse. Then only the horse is going to be nice to us. So this is the kind of a what we're trying to work and connect with. So the leadership program have to be experienced, then only it can be known more. So we are working on that. We shall be making small videos of those, and surely we'll share with interested people about the leadership program also in coming soon. Let's see.
Yeah. Wonderful. I'd definitely be looking forward to this. So great, Navneet. I think it was an extremely interesting session, and thank you ever so much for enlightening us about these breeds. I really hope this actually, you know, helps in promoting these breeds a great deal more. So yeah, thank you.
See you soon.
All right then.
All right.
Thank